I've been thinking about coming to a library again and giving a presentation, and I started thinking, I grew up in a small town in Madison County, and my aunt was the librarian. And that had two kinds of effects. One, she got all of the new books and hid some of them away and said, you shouldn't know about these things. And I suppose I was 8 or 9 or something like that. Then later on, I became the Saturday cleaner of the library. And I spent most of my time, I wasn't paid by the hour, because she knew better than to do that. I spent a lot of my time just enjoying seeing all of the different books. And I often wonder if that had something about going to college and taking things seriously, and eventually going to grad school and getting a doctorate and so on, that that was the effects maybe of her literary inclination and the exposure of a, in a certain way, to an intellectual life, a life of a certain kind. And tonight, Janet will be showing us slides of several different aspects of, let's just say, life, living, earning, what type of household you'll be in, and so on. All of these things are not changing every day, but they are changing. In other words, we want to take a picture, or present a rounded picture, if you will, through different minor pictures of Japanese life and where it's going. Japan has a very rapidly aging population. These are people in the group that is over 65 years old. There are a small amount. The figures are millions, 6,236,000,000 and 65. Look at it now, 26 million. At the same time, the numbers of young people went up for a while and now are coming down. Japan has a national budget. Both a net budget and a non-net. And any way you look at it, Japan's public debt is very high relative to other countries and increasing. To convert Japanese per capita incomes using the information that we have here, we can see that it's grown steadily as the country prospered, but now is starting to shrink. And as of yet, I don't know what this means, but per capita income may turn out to be very important, depending on where it's and how it's shared within different people with different jobs, different incomes, and different types of households. Here, we have a chart that shows from the 1990s up to a couple years ago that Japan's taxes are very low compared to other countries, although ours are down in their lower, Germany, France, Great Britain. What does this mean? What causes it? For a long time, the party in power in Japan, the Liberal Democratic Party, was very generous in taxation of economic entities and also taxation of the agricultural sector. I assume that's part of it, but I don't know beyond that. And what I'm doing in this book, and you are experiencing through the various slides, is I'm worrying at things, and it's kind of gnawing and trying to get a, you know, the societies are just so complicated, but I'm hoping that by taking a camera, you might say, and looking from this way, and this way, and this way, and this way, and so on, that I may get an insight into what's going on. You see that there's been a whopper of an increase in education at the high school level. There's some at the Simongako professional schools, and also a very systematic increase between the 70s and 2000 in university degrees and grad school degrees. The country is better educated. At the same time all this is happening in the education field, there are far fewer farmers. Farmers are practically disappearing from the population. There are a fair amount of people in large companies, both in the manufacturing side and in the management side. We see services. If I get the colors right, I want to be sure I get that right. Where are services? Services are increasing. And sales, retail and wholesale. So farmers have just about disappeared in relevant senses vis-a-vis urban and industrial occupations of different kinds. And in this, well, we looked at the changes in households and some of the other population changes, the aging population, the whole book this is taken from, or the ideas behind it, are people got to save. As, you know, with a government that has its problems and the increasing in the number of older families, older households, I want to see how savings work out. Yeah. Here is a profile, and this one fascinates me, of industries in post-war Japan, going all the way back to the 50s. And here we have just another measure of the decline of agriculture. And here we have an increase in manufacturing, and this is just the number of firms. No, in the thousands of persons. Okay. Increasing manufacturing population, so to speak, goes up, stables, and comes down. And then in the non-manufacturing, service, retail, medical, etc. area, an enormous rise. Anyhow, higher salaries in the area of manufacturing, which is slowly declining, and lower salaries in this area of wholesale and retail sales, they're part of that picture that went up like this of non-manufacturing occupations. So what I'm thinking is, of course, that we're backing up from the question of the aging population and the household shape, the structure shape and so forth, saying, you know, who's going to make enough to say, other things being, you know, looking at them in terms of household differences and so forth, and it looks like the capability of ordinary people to save may actually decrease through changes in the occupation structure of the country. Well, what we have done is process. The book closes on a suggestion. You know, there are several hundred big and small bureaucratic units that they that have their own favorite survey or way of producing data. And these go on and on and on. And what we've done today is exploit these in a sense and try to draw pictures out from them. But the pictures are always single-dimensional slices or near that. And in the book, I end on proposing new ways to measure people and their life experiences, their employment experiences, their sizes of places of work, their capability of saving, their educational level, putting all of these things into one study, so and running this out of the cabinet rather than out of one of the bureaucratic bailiwicks that has its own habits and will argue correctly that they should keep the categories over time, because how will you know the effects of time? They're very, you know, they make excellent arguments about it, but I think a new kind of way of measuring the Japanese and other populations. You know, I was thinking of starting this evening's comments thinking about the election campaign and how many assertions that were made on the basis of really fragments of information in a situation that was just as complex as the ones we talked about here. The book ends by proposing that the society be measured better, and I think I make the argument that go back to the saying that an army marches on its stomach, and suggests that a effective country marches on good statistics, or something kind of corny like that. And I did go to the government's main headquarters where they assemble statistics from all the different offices to propose this to them. And it was really kind of funny because, like other government offices, there were cops standing out in front and so forth. And when I came in, they all saluted. and then we had a long discussion about whether some of these I was proposing could make any sense, and they argued and so on. So we don't really know where society will go. We don't really, at least by non-acceptance of the idea, we have what we have now in the way of measuring this, of social change in the sense of attitudes and also of political things. Thank you.